Hey, what's up guys, and welcome back. Today we're going to look at how to load in custom Arnold procedurals, and more specifically, how to render Mandelbulbs in Maya with Arnold. There are loads of websites about 3D fractal art, but not so many for production apps, and even less so for Maya. I've been interested with fractals for quite some time, and I have a lot of software I'd like to showcase on the channel, but for now, we're just going to look at the standard Mandelbulb after I stumbled upon this custom procedural. It's pretty easy to set up, but there are specific steps to get it to work properly. On ArnoldRenderer.com, there's a tutorial for setting this up, but we're going to go over it in a bit more depth and then animate it with some custom PyMel scripts. So this page explains what the parameters do, which will be a useful reference later. Scroll down and grab the compiled Mandelbulb procedural. We're using Arnold 6, so download that for all platforms. We're also going to need the Arnold scene source file example here, and yes, it's literally called an ass file. Even Arnold's command line renderer is called kick, so there you go. We're just going to call them ass files. In the link in the description, I have also included these files and the documentation just in case they are unavailable later. And we also are going to need these two Python scripts, which are only available here. So one is for adding attributes to a custom shape, and another one is for animating these and saving separate ass sequences. So make sure you go ahead and download those. So before we bring in those files, let's set up a project folder. So we're going to need a scenes folder, a folder for our ass sequences, and then a scripts folder. So let's drag these files down so we can move the Python files into the scripts folder and then extract the zip file. So inside the zip file, there are going to be several files that we don't need. So this is for Windows, so we only require the DLL. If you are on Mac or in Linux, you will need to use the .dylib and .so files respectively, and then use these instead of the DLL. The MTD file is a shader metadata file, but we don't need it. Grab the DLL and paste this in the root folder, and then just delete what I don't need. So inside Maya, let's go ahead and set our project and create a default workspace. Now, a quick note before we begin, I'm using the latest version of Arnold at the time of the recording, so that is listed there. Now, the Arnold version is important. So this DLL was compiled with Arnold version 6.0.1. If you are using the version of Arnold that came with the initial release of Maya 2020, you will need to update Arnold. So this requires at least version 6.0.1 to work. So there are several ways to install the DLL procedural. The first way is to place it in the Arnold procedurals folder, and to find the location of this, in the Maya Mel script editor, just type in system set Arnold, and then execute the script. So this will show the path for the shaders and the procedurals, so just grab the latter, and then paste this in a file explorer window, and then paste in the DLL to this location. Another way is to set your own custom procedural folder. This would be useful if you want to keep your own collection of DLLs separate from the Arnold installation, which honestly is probably better than the previous example. Now for this, you'll need to find the Maya environment file, which is typically under your C drive, users, your username, documents, Maya, your Maya version number, and the Maya.env file. So inside this file, if you just open it up in a text editor, type in Arnold underscore plugin underscore path and set that equal to your path. You can, in this case, just use the project directory and then just load in that path. You would save this file, and then when you restart Maya, it will take effect. Now, with both of these methods, the DLL will be loaded anytime that Arnold is loaded, regardless of whether you're using it or not, but it will be accessible in any scene. The last method is to load it from the scene itself. To do this, make sure you switch to Arnold, go to System, Search Paths, and then add in this search path under the plugin search path. So to do this, you can grab the path, and then you will also need to append in the name of the file as well. So this is the method I'll be using, but use whichever one works best for you. All right, I'm gonna expand Maya now, and then I'm gonna redo my UI just so we can see everything on the page. So I'm gonna open up the script editor and dock that to the bottom, and then I'm gonna do the same thing with a hypershade. Then I'm gonna open up the Arnold render view and then just dock that to the left. So this way we can see as many things as possible without having to switch windows constantly. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and save the scene, and then we can load in the stand-in. So to test this out, go to Arnold, stand-in, and load in the ass file. Then you can just click render, and this is what should appear. Now, if you run into issues, open up the script editor, and it probably says that the DLL was not installed. So first check your Arnold version number. So as I said before, this DLL was compiled in Arnold 6.0.1, so you may need to update Arnold and try again. Otherwise, you will need to check the Arnold log for details, And to do this, go to Render Settings, Diagnostics, and under Log, change the verbosity level to Debug, check File, and then choose a location for the file. Make sure you add the .log extension. And I also recommend putting this in its own folder because when you render sequences, it will save an individual log file per frame. This might seem excessive, but it's actually far easier to determine where a frame failed, for example. So you can just load in that specific log, and instead of having to parse through hundreds of frames, you can just go to the specific log of that frame and see what the errors are. So once that is done, we'll go down to render, update full scene, and when you restart the render, it will start generating the log file. So let's take a look at the log. Open that up in a text editor, and you should be able to see that the DLL was loaded. If not, it will give you an error message saying something like, the DLL was not installed. You can also see if it loaded in the Arnold RenderView log, but I do recommend saving out an external log file for when you start using sequences. So I spent ages trying to figure out why it wasn't working for me, and it was all due to the fact that I was using an old version of Arnold. So I'd like to shout out to Stephen Blair for the tip on this. Increasing the verbosity of the log is definitely worth doing. All right, so assuming that everything works, let's take a gander at what we've got. So the Mandelbulb is created as a point cloud at render time, and by default it has a grid size of 800. So that's 800 cubed cells. So that's 512 million little spheres. Now with this, you can zoom around, but there's nothing to do. Plus there's a bunch of stuff that we don't need. So if we open up the example Mandelbulb ass file, you can see that there's a plane, there's lights, there's a material, and just a bunch of stuff that we don't actually need. The only thing that we care about is this section here. So let's copy this and then paste this in a new file. We can also delete this shader line because we'll be adding our own in a moment. So go ahead and save this as a copy. Then load in version 2 of the ass file. So now we've just stripped the scene of everything except the point cloud, so we'll need to go ahead and add a new material and some lights. So in the Hypershade, if you just click the tab key in your workspace, you can type in AI standard, then grab the standard surface, rename this to be Mandelbulb, then make sure the AI stand-in is selected, grab the material node and assign it to the selection. We'll just grab a light here just so we can see what we're doing and then re-render. Now, one annoying thing with this procedural in particular is that we have no idea where it is, and sometimes even the bounding box disappears. So what I recommend is just grabbing in a sphere and scaling that up so we can see it in the viewport. And when we've scaled it up enough, you can set the render stats so it's not going to be visible in the render, and then set the object display to template. So this will give you a rough idea of where it is in your viewport. Okay, so next we're just going to add in some area lights, and I'm using a 3-point setup here, but in this case the rim light is actually going to be the most dominant light. I'm also playing around with the temperature to get a cooler light. We can also rotate the standard object and find a different angle for it, so you will notice significantly different results, especially on different power levels, just by rotating the Mandelbulb. So if you don't like one particular side, have a look from a different angle and maybe it will give you an interesting result. Now on my search to figure out what the hell I was doing, I stumbled upon this site by Vivek Reddy. He has some scripts for just what I wanted. However, these were for an old version of the DLL and for Arnold, and it doesn't work with the current build. Plus there are some things that I wanted to change and add some functionality. So I use this as a reference to create my own scripts. Now, if you haven't downloaded these already, you need to make sure you grab the Python scripts in the link in the description, because we're going to need that for the next part. So in the script editor, go ahead and open up the add attributes script. Now, this is the same thing as adding attributes to the extra attributes tab manually, and this does add to the shape node, not the transform node. If we go down and select extra attributes and then run the script, if you scroll down again, you can see that those new parameters have been added. If you don't have the extra attributes tab open, the placement of the parameters might be a little higher up. For some reason, if it's not open, they go higher up, and if it is open, they go to the bottom. So if you don't see them right away, just look up. Now let's have a look at some of these settings. So in the documentation, it gives you a brief description of what they all do. The most important thing for render time is going to be the grid size, but it's also going to increase the fidelity of the shape. And the second one is the power level. So you can get dramatically different shapes using different power levels. Another one that does change the shape quite dramatically is going to be the Julia setting. So if Julia is checked, then instead of using the Mandelbrot, you're going to use a Julia set. So basically, the Mandelbrot is connected and the Julia set is not, and will give you more of a a cloud-like appearance instead of a more dense shape. And when Julia is on, these C values are used. If it's unchecked, then you can ignore these. So for the rest of the parameters, just reference the documentation. All right, so let's go ahead and animate one of these. So we'll grab the power level. I'll change this to 3 at the beginning, and then I'll key this channel. And then I'm just gonna go to 120 frames. Now, one note is you do need to make sure your timeline is the same length as the number of ASS files that you want to generate, because automatically it will use what you have as your timeline. So at the very end here, we'll set that to 20. And for the rest, we'll just leave those at the default settings. Okay, so now we need to save out a separate ASS file for each frame, and then these will need to be loaded in as a sequence. To do that, we'll use that second script. And keep in mind that these custom attributes don't actually do anything unless we run that second script. They're just there to allow us to record the values and for the script to save them to a file. So if you change anything here, you'll have to run the script again and then re-import a sequence. So once again, in the Python script editor, load up the Mandelbulb animate script. Now you have to change the output location manually because it doesn't do this for you. Typically you'd want this in some kind of custom folder inside your project folder. So go to wherever that folder is, copy the path and paste it in the file path. Now you do need to make sure that you either use forward slashes or a double backslash. Again, this is for Windows, so it might be different depending on your operating system. And then you can change the file name and the file name parameter, and then the padding if you want to change your leading zeros. Now the rest of this script just takes those parameters that we just added and then creates a new ASS file for every frame. Go ahead and run the script. If you go to the folder, you can see that there's 120 different ASS files that were saved out. And if you select these, you can see that the power level is changing as we progress through the animation. So select the stand-in, and then you want to make sure that you load in the new sequence and check the Use File Sequence button. So to test this out, we'll just go ahead and render the first frame. So this is going to give you a dramatically different shape to what we were looking at before at a lower power level. If we go halfway and then render again, and then you can see we get a different shape again, and at the very end, we get a different shape. So this is just simply from increasing the power level of the function. So to set this up to render frames, if we go to the Common tab of Render Settings, here I'm just going to use a file name token using the scene name as the folder path and the file name as well. So adding that slash will create a folder and then a file name inside that folder. So in image size, I'm just going to set this to be UHD 4K. Now in the Arnold renderer, I'm going to enable adaptive sampling, but then I'm going to lower the maximum. Under system, I'm going to use the GPU. Now, just a quick note about this. The first part of rendering a frame in this case is going to be CPU bound because it has to calculate the position of all the points. So if you have a very high grid size, this could take several minutes per frame depending on your system. But once it has positioned those points and it knows where they go, then rasterizing the image will be faster on a GPU if you have a good one. It doesn't require very much memory to render this on the GPU. I'm going to go into the AOVs and add a depth pass. Then we can close the render settings and then render another frame. So now we can change the pass from beauty to Z and take a look at the depth pass. By default, this is almost always going to be white because unlike V-Ray, you can't choose a threshold of values to choose from. This is going to render the entire scene. So you will have to play around with the exposure and the gamma to get a good image in post. And you can use that for depth of field or some atmospheric perspective. So back in render settings, I'm going to go and select the driver for that AOV and make sure that the merged AOV option is checked, and then do the same in the common tab. This will give us a multi-channel EXR file, which is generally how you composite things. Also be sure to set this to an animation and put the extension at the end and update your end frame. So anytime that you want to change settings, let's say I wanted to increase the grid size to 800, by changing it here in the extra attributes, we're not actually changing anything until we rerun the Python script. So keep that in mind that anytime you want to make a change, you got to execute the script again and then load in the sequence again. So if we compare the difference between a grid size of 400 and 800, you can see that there's a dramatic difference in the length of time it takes and also the quality level or the fidelity of the shape. So if we A/B these, you can note the differences. Now you might actually want a lower grid size because it will give you interesting results, but with an abstract kind of a feel to it. So finally, if you are ready to export your frame sequence, change our main tab to rendering, go to render. Unless you pay for a license of Arnold, you can't batch render, unfortunately, so we have to use the render sequence option. Now, if you have changed your camera, you go into the option box and change it there, but I'm just using the perspective one. And when you click it, a Maya frame buffer will open up and then it will begin rendering frames here. And here is the finished animation, where you can really see how the power levels are influencing shape. So here are some examples of different grid sizes and what they look like. You can also have a look at changing the orbit threshold and the size of the sphere. You can also have a lot more fun with playing around with different lights and adding post effects such as depth of field. In the next video, we're going to take a look at the source code, add in some more functionality, and compile our own custom procedural. So then we can use other formulas, and we can add things like phase shifting, and just more parameters to control. Anyway, I hope you guys learned something. If you did, a like really helps out the channel. I also have a Discord server now, so it's easier to ask questions and post screenshots. So check that out if you're interested. All right, guys, thank you so much for watching. See you next time. Peace.